Morris Brown AME Church here in Charleston, South Carolina. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our Pentecost online worship experience. It's the vision of Morris Brown AME Church to be a Christ-centered church glorifying God by serving the spiritual, social, and economic needs of a diverse community. Let us worship God today in spirit and truth, and we remember the Spirit falling upon the church. And the church became a living organism. For being able to gather virtually on this Sunday of Pentecost, that we remember how you sent your spirit upon the church and the church was born. Lord, we thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your generosity in sending it. And Lord, the same way that you sent it upon that first century church, Lord, let your spirit fall afresh on us today. Continue to bless us in this time of pandemic. Bless us in this time of uncertainty. Let us realize, oh God, that there's nothing that we go through that you weren't able to fix. Lord, continue to bless the sick and the hurting. Lord, bless those who are bereaved. Bless your church. Bless our country. Bless our elected officials and all of those who have authority. It's these things we ask in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. It says this from the New Revised Standard Version. That when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Joys are flowing like a river since the Comforter has come. He abides with us forever. Make the trusting one his home. Oh, wonder for salvation, where we always see His grace. What a perfect habitation! Oh, what a quiet resting place! Oh, blessed quietness! Oh, holy quietness! What a
today for the assurance that you give us in our souls. We thank you for this preaching moment. We pray now, God, that the words of my mouth, that the meditation of each and every heart will be acceptable in your sight. Oh God, our strength and our Redeemer. Let the people of God say amen. I'm glad on this Pentecost Sunday that there is a word from the Lord that's found in the Gospel of John, John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39. Reading from the New Revised Standard Version, it says this: on the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me. And let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive. For as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. For just a moment this morning, I want to preach on the subject, God's cure for a thirsty believer. God's cure for a thirsty believer. Without a doubt, at some point in time in our lives, we have all experienced the feeling of being thirsty. It's in these moments that our mouths get dry and we feel a tingling sensation in the back of our throats. As our thirst intensifies, it compels us to leave whatever we're doing to go and get something to quench our thirst. And my brothers and sisters, can I tell you today that nothing quenches our thirst like water? It's only water that's able to quench our thirst on a hot sunny day. It's only water that's able to quench our thirst from the saltiness and seasoning of food. It's only water that's able to quench our thirst when we've been walking around the theme park all day. My friends, when we get thirsty, we have to find something that's able to quench our thirst. This is important because if we go thirsty too long, sooner or later, we have become dehydrated. Dehydration occurs when someone consistently loses more fluid than they take in. And being dehydrated can be very dangerous, because when someone experiences dehydration for too long, it will cause their bodies not to function properly. Dehydration can cause someone to go into shock because of a low blood volume. Dehydration could cause someone to have a seizure. Dehydration could cause someone to have urinary and kidney problems. And when someone is dehydrated, they can have very serious health complications. As I look at this passage afresh this week, I became painfully aware that not all thirst and dehydration affect our physical bodies. But brothers and sisters, if we are honest with ourselves, there are times that we get thirsty and dehydrated down in our spirits. I must confess that I'd be less than a gospel preacher if I only allowed you to believe that all thirst was physical or all dehydration was physical. But how many know it's a such thing as being spiritually dehydrated or being spiritually thirsty? You see, a physical thirst will affect your body, but a spiritual thirst will affect your belief. A physical thirst will affect your temperature, but a spiritual thirst will make us vulnerable to temptation. A physical thirst will affect our health, but a spiritual thirst will affect our holiness. And so we got to be careful that we don't get consumed with watering our bodies, that we forget to water our spirits. With this distinction in mind, we find ourselves in this seventh chapter in the Gospel of John. It's important to understand that as we read this passage, that Jesus is not talking about a physical thirst, but he's talking about a spiritual thirst. Look at what the text says in verse 37. It says, on the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me." It's here that we find ourselves on the final day of the Feast of Tabernacles. And it's here that Jesus promises living water to believers who are thirsty. The Feast of Tabernacles lasted for 7 days. And it's important that we understand that in the first century, they celebrated the Feast of Tabernacles with a water pouring ritual. That the first 6 days of the feast, they had a big giant golden container, and they would go get water from the pool of Siloam, and they would carry the water in the giant container to the temple. And when they reached the water gate at the temple, the trumpet would blow 3 times. And it was here that the people and the priests would process around the temple, shaking their branches. And the golden container of water was taken to the priest who was on duty. And when he had 2 silver bowls on the altar, he would take the water out of the golden container and he would pour it into the bowls. One of the bowls was for water, and the other was for wine. And after the bowls were filled, the contents were poured over the altar. But the 7th day was different, because on the 7th day, people were processed around the temple and around the altar 7 times. And people believed that when the Messiah had come, that it would be the Messiah who would provide the water that they needed to drink. And so here, it's on the final day of this feast that the last of the water pouring ceremonies, in the midst of all the singing and the rejoicing, Jesus steps forward. And Jesus invites those who believe in him and believe he was the Messiah, and they were thirsty, to come forward so that he could give them living water. And so Jesus provides the living water on the great day to reinforce the fact, listen, the Messiah is here. And not only does he just offer any kind of water, but he offers living water. And can I tell you today, I'm so glad that Jesus didn't offer any kind of water, because they could go to the pool of Siloam and get ordinary water. But Jesus offers something that only he could give, and that's living water. And you know, someone went and asked the question, Pastor, what's so different about living water? Well, can I tell you that there is a significant difference? Because physical water can quench your physical thirst. And the same way you drink it, a few minutes later, you're going to be thirsty again. But living water will quench your spiritual thirst. It'll get down deep on the inside. And what I like about the living water is that when you drink it, you will never be thirsty again. And I don't know about you, but I've been through some times in my life when I needed this living water. You see, when your soul gets thirsty, you need some living water. When your soul gets dehydrated, you need some living water. When your soul is parched, you need some living water. I don't know about you, but I thank God for living water. But the text goes on to say, at the beginning of verse 38, and let the one who believes in me drink. Let me tell you that there is a condition for drinking the living water. And that is that only those who believe in Jesus can drink it. You know, brothers and sisters, if I'm honest, there are too many times that we underestimate the profound power of belief. Sometimes we live in a world, and the world we live in tries to convince us to believe, not to believe in things that we can't see, and not to believe in things that the world can't understand. But I'll stop by to remind us today that we can't let anyone or anything prevent us from believing that Jesus can make all things possible. Our belief in Jesus will give us peace in confusing and chaotic situations. Our belief in Jesus will give us hope when it seems like we don't know if tomorrow is coming or not. Our belief in Jesus will give us assurance that every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. And so Jesus says, listen, if you thirsty and you believe in me, come forward and take a drink of the water that I can give. But the text goes on to say in the second part of verse 38, as the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water. I must confess that biblical scholars can't agree on how this part of the verse should be translated. They can't agree whether it should say out of the heart or out of the belly. This part of the verse makes reference to several Old Testament passages. But when you read the text in the context of this passage, I believe that out of the heart is a better translation. The reason is our beliefs always come out of our heart. And since belief is a prerequisite to drinking the living water, it means that Jesus instills the living water into the believers. And out of their hearts with their belief comes the living water of God. You see, living water can never abide where belief in Jesus is not present. And so it's in verse 39 that John gives us a commentary on these teachings of Jesus. The beginning of the verse says, now Jesus said this about the Spirit. In other words, there is a connection between the promise of living water and the promise of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is saying that if you think that there's something to see about the outpouring of the living water, then you ain't seen nothing yet. Because the day is coming when you will experience the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And it's this outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will usher in a new era. It's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will bring relief to thirsty souls. It's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will bring revival to thirsty souls. It's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will bring rejuvenation to thirsty souls. It's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that will bring restoration to thirsty souls. As we come on this day of Pentecost, I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that the Spirit is able to rehydrate us. Only the Holy Spirit can bring hydration to dry ministries. Only the Holy Spirit can bring hydration to dry missions. Only the Holy Spirit can bring hydration to dry ministers. Only the Holy Spirit can bring hydration to dry members. Aren't you glad to know today that the church can never get so dry that a good dose of the Spirit can hydrate us again? But it's the second part of verse 39 that says, which believers in Jesus were to receive. Indeed, this verse sheds light on who receives the Holy Spirit. It lets us know that the Holy Spirit is a gift to those who believe in Jesus. This is interesting. Because sometimes people will say we need to do all kinds of things to get the Holy Spirit. But I stop by to remind us on this day of Pentecost that we don't need any special formulas. We don't need special finances. We don't need to do any kind of special feat. But all we need is faith in Jesus. And when we believe in Jesus, the gift of the Spirit will follow. And so the text ends in the final clause of verse 39. When it says, for as yet there was no Spirit because Jesus was not yet glorified. I don't want us to misunderstand this verse. Because what the verse is not saying is that the Holy Spirit did not exist. Because can I remind us that the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Godhead. And there's never been a time that the Holy Spirit did not exist. But what Jesus is saying in this verse is that the time that he's speaking to his listeners, that the gift of the Holy Spirit had not been poured out into believers. Because until this point, the Spirit would rest on people, but not rest in people. And Jesus lets us know that before the Spirit can rest in you, that Jesus had to be glorified. Well, what does it mean that he had to be glorified? In the book of John, glorified always makes reference to Jesus' death, resurrection, and return to the Father. And this is significant because it's the glorified Christ that's able to speak to the heart and spirit of a believer like no time before. And it's only when he was dead, when he was buried, he rose again and ascends to the Father that the Holy Spirit will fall down. Aren't you glad to know today that the Spirit will fall and make all things possible? As we come to a close, I'm reminded of the time that a young man spent his spring break out in the country with his aunt and his uncle. And one evening after they finished dinner, they were sitting out on the porch. And the young man noticed that his aunt was enjoying a drink. And every night she would drink this drink that he didn't know what it was. And she was enjoying it so much that he began to imagine what the drink must have tasted like. Finally, the curiosity got the best of him. And this young man said, "Hey, Auntie, what's that you're drinking?" Now, Aunt never answered his question. She looked at him and said, "Do you want to taste it?" The young man responded, "Yes, if it's okay with you." The young man tasted it and found out that it was the nastiest stuff that he had ever tasted. He spit it out and looked confused at his aunt. He said, "Auntie, I don't understand how every night you can bring yourself to drink this, because it's always so nasty." The lady looked at the boy, she smiled. She said, "Yes, I agree that the first time I drank it, it was nasty. But even though it was nasty at first, I kept on drinking." She said, "I realized that the benefits of drinking it was better, far outweighed the taste of the drink." And she said, "Every time I drink it, it got a little bit better and better." As I take my seat, we can learn a lot from this lady, because being filled with the Holy Spirit sometimes seems like a different experience. You see, it's only the Spirit that can make you pray for people that misuse you. It's only the Spirit that can make you turn one cheek when they slap the first one. It's only the Spirit that'll make you love people that hate you. But I tell you, it might seem different at first, but keep on drinking it. And I'm glad that on the day of Pentecost, that we reminded that a good dose of the Spirit will make all the difference. How many know that it's the Spirit that'll make you walk in a different direction? It's the Spirit that'll make you talk differently. It's the Spirit that'll make you forgive differently. It's the Spirit that'll make you love differently. And can I tell you that when traveling days are done, it's the Spirit that'll make you die differently? I don't know about you, but what the world needs now is a good dose of the Spirit. Because when the Spirit falls, everything will change. God has a cure for a thirsty believer. And that's to drink the living water of the Holy Spirit. Maybe there's someone listening today, watching, and you realize that you have not really named the name Jesus. And I tell you today that you can't get the Spirit until you accept Jesus in your heart. It's only when we believe in Him that the Spirit will fall down upon us. Maybe there's somebody today looking for a church home, and I'll be the first one to admit that Morris Brown is not a perfect church. But I'm so glad when the Spirit falls that all things become possible. And if you're looking for a church home, we would love to be able to walk together to be the church that Christ is calling us to be. And maybe you say, "Well, I started out a long time ago, preacher, but I got dusty and dry on the way." And I'm here to tell you that God is still able to hydrate us for the journey and give us what we need to make it. God, for those who are receiving Christ today, for those who are joining the church, for those who are rededicating themselves to you. Lord, we lift them up to you, and we ask you, oh God, to give us what we cannot give ourselves. And once again, God, allow your spirit to fall on us so that we may become the church you call us to be. It's these things we ask in the name of Jesus, we pray. Let the church say amen. And if you responded to any one of those appeals for Salvation Church membership or rededication, please visit us on our church website or give us a call, and we would love to be able to make this journey together. And now we'll have our stewardship moment. Stewardship is very important in the church because Christian stewardship is a way that we respond to the goodness of God in our lives. And financially, we express Christian stewardship in three ways. Through the presentation of tithes, that's the 10% that belongs to God. Through the giving of offerings, that's what we give on top of the tithe in order to say thank you. And through our capital campaigns, that's when we covenant and work together to, at this point, for campaign 2020, to pay off the mortgage of our church so that we may be able to be more invested and impactful in our community. We thank those who continue to be faithful in their giving. May God continue to bless you. And we have, even as we worship virtually, three ways that we're able to give. We can go online to the church website, www.morrisbrownmechurch.org. You see it on your screen. And you can follow the tabs for giving. You can text to give by texting MBAME 1866. To 888-364-4483. And they will send you a message to follow to be able to give. Or simply you can put a check in the mail. Mail it to Morris Brown AME Church, 13 Morris Street, Charleston, South Carolina, 29403. God, for the gifts and the givers, we give you thanks. Continue to bless us to be the people you call us to be. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And as we come at the end of this worship service on this Pentecost Sunday, we continue to ask God to pour out his spirit upon us that we may become the sons and daughters of the living God. Now receive this benediction. Now unto him who showed up able to keep him from to present you faultless before his throne with exceeding joy. To the only wise God our Savior, be glory and majesty and dominion power, now and forever we pray.
God is spoken, let the church say church, say amen.